I have the pleasure to give you some information about Telekom Deutschland's approach to network function virtualization, what we are doing, what we're planning to do, what we are thinking about, and that's about my presentation. And in between, I will show you a short movie which we made to explain the network function virtualization, to explain the rationales behind it. And so lean back and enjoy the show. What I want to do, I'll give a short introduction about NFV. NFV, more than a hype? Is it a question or is it a statement? I will give some words about that. And then I'll talk about the network function virtualization as we are currently doing, planning it within Telekom Deutschland, why we want to do it, what we think about, and how we plan to do it. And later on, at the end of my presentation, I will raise some questions about open source pros and cons, looking from a network operator's point of view on that stuff, open source in general, and later on also OpenStack in special. And as Christmas becomes nearer and nearer, I will have a wish list with me about some topics I'd like to raise and I'd like to think the OpenStack community about. So just some words to my person. My name is Stefan Häuser, Stephen or Stefan, however you like to pronounce it. I'm program manager for the virtualization program within the German branch of the technology part of Deutsche Telekom. And we started our program last year in summer. The management decided, yeah, it's quite an interesting thing. Network function virtualization, let's think about it. Let's think about it in some more depth. And so we put a lot of experts together. Some of them I'm glad to have with me. So I'm not the techie guy. If you have later on some technical questions, I may have to pass them to my experts. Thanks, guys, that you are here with me. And I hope you support me. That's it for that, yeah. Let me just have a look on my notes. Fine. So, network function virtualization, more than a hype? What do you think? I just did a search. What do you think? How many results did I get? What do you believe? I just put NFV in the mask. What do you think? How many results? Pardon? 10,000? I'd like to hear some more. Okay. 1.3 million. But I have to admit, it took me a lot of work to convince my browser not to show the Norddeutsche Fußballverband, the Northern German Soccer Association, at the first results. So I had to do a lot of work to get these results directly on the first page. So there may be a lot of unrelated topics, or let's say topics not related to network function virtualization with that. But there is, anyhow, if it's 1.3 million or if it's only 1.2 or 1.1 million, there's a lot of things going on network function virtualization. So my statement is, it's more than a hype. We left, if you think about the Gartner hype cycle, we left this high peak, but we still have a long way to go to have it really in the network and to have it work in the network, in a carrier-grade network, I have to say. So network function virtualization is, of course, one innovation driver for telco providers like Deutsche Telekom. so far that movie. So, parts of my questions are already answered, but I want to emphasize just two points why we are doing it. The one is scaling. As mentioned in the movie before, to base it on a standard hardware, not on a vendor-specific hardware, not to have the silos, but to distribute it over a lot of other unused servers can help you to use your resources more efficiently. So, just to switch off what you don't need, or at least have in a low power mode running, and later on, if you need more of your resources, you just fire up these resources and use them. It's just shown here for two virtual network functions, VNF1 and VNF2. But if you have more of them, the idea behind is that you will have the peaks, hopefully, not at the same time for all of your virtual network functions, but to have distributed peaks. As mentioned in the movie, for the example, the SMS, just give you a figure. At the 31st of December last year, starting at 11 p.m., till the 1st of January, 2 a.m., there were sent about 40 million SMS alone inside the network of Deutsche Telekom. I'm not talking about SMS which were sent to other providers or which were sent from other providers into the network of Deutsche Telekom. Just within the network of Deutsche Telekom, within 3 hours, 40 million SMS. So you need, as we currently have, a lot of resources unused most of the year. And the idea behind the network function virtualization is to have these unused resources used by other network functions and then use their resources, which they don't need, because usually at Sylvester, at the midnight, most of people are having their Sylvester party or New Year's Eve party and not working, though you may use these resources just for kind of that services. So scaling and better usage of resources is one thing. And the other thing, as also mentioned, is time to market. To decouple the hardware cycle and the software cycle. So currently, we just have minor releases of new software based on our hardware we have. But if you have a major release, then in most cases, you also have to change the hardware. Or if you have to change the hardware, you also have to change the software. And therefore, a decoupling of hardware and software, as shown in the lower figure, that's one possibility, one chance of network function virtualization we want to use with that. So, scaling and time to market or decoupling of hardware and software. And that's a rationale, that are the two main drivers besides others which were mentioned before, operational issues, energy consumption and things like that. Yes, the whole bunch, that's the rationale behind of going into such an, of course, for a traditional network provider, new field. What we think about? As we talk about network functions, we have several different network functions. We have, let's say, to give a rough cluster, two kinds of functions. We have the one who are network and data agnostic who need a lot of power in terms of bits per second, which have to be distributed to a customer. These functions will be distributed over our network near the customer. That's what we call a talk, or what we call front-end data center, or FDC. These FDCs will be distributed around Germany, several locations, currently thinking about 20 locations where we will have that, but no final decision so far. And this will be located, as shown here, in a distributed cloud. So we are not talking about a distinct data center, we are talking about the cloud, the FDC cloud. And the applications shall be cloud aware. The redundancy will be handled by the application itself, meaning in the front-end data center, we don't have any backup redundancy concepts or things like that. The application is responsible to ensure that. And on the other hand, we have the so-called back-end data center, which will be only a smaller number, currently talking about 3. And there we will have the stateful applications, the applications needing databases, needing a lot of computing power and things like that. And that will be located into one of our back-end data centers. And there we will have, of course, high availability concepts. But again, if the application needs a higher availability that then can be provided by the infrastructure itself, then the application has to ensure that there is a high availability of this application. That means, in the back-end data center case, we may install an application in more than one location, and to have the combination of both locations to reach an availability of 99.999 whatever percent, more than the infrastructure itself can provide. And for the FDC case, we say, okay, the application itself has to ensure the interworking and the availability, meaning if there is one FDC, let's say, by flood or by a fire out of order, another FDC can be taking over the work and the load of the FDC, which is not or which is unusable for that time. So the application itself, the infrastructure on the one hand, shall support that, and the application on the other hand has to make use of it. I think this picture is well known. I don't have to explain it. Just to emphasize the hardware and the virtualization layer and the NFV, the manual block on this side. That's the data center overview as given by ETSI NFV. Our approach looks a little bit different. Okay, I step out of the pictures. Just give me a sign when you're done. But the slides will be uploaded, so there is no need to take a picture. Except my face is not uploaded. Okay. So the main difference is here. Of course, you have noticed the open stack here, but the main difference is there. Whereas the ETSI picture says, okay, We have the orchestrator doing the overall stuff. We have the VNF managers, and we have the infrastructure manager, and the VNF managers may have access to the infrastructure managers. We say, no way. The VNF manager must not, no, should not, nor shall not, must not have access, direct access on the, what we call infrastructure orchestration. The rationale behind is, if you have, even in our case where we are talking about a private cloud and not a public cloud, if we have different product owners, different providers of your network function within a huge company like Deutsche Telekom, you will have different interests. You will have different policies for scaling of those applications. And if you don't get a single and unique view on your infrastructure, you'll be lost. You don't know, in a case of scaling, what's really available. Everybody scales out, but what's happening in case of conflict? Who will solve this conflict if they have the direct access? Therefore, we say, okay, we bundle VNF manager and application orchestration. We have them. And only via the orchestration, there is an access to the infrastructure. So we have one point of truth where we know about what's happening here. And that's the main difference, besides some other minor points, but that's the main difference regarding our well-known ETSI picture. Though that's what we plan to do. And open source, open stack. Some remarks from an operator's point of view. There are lots of discussions, or had been lots of discussions, within our company. Shall we use an open source software, or should we stay with the well-known software provided by our vendors? Should we stay with the silo approach, or shall we move to the more open, or hopefully totally open, approach using network function virtualization? I just took them pros and cons. Of course, positive from our perspective is we have only a limited vendor dependency, community-driven development and enhancement, and, of course, fast innovation cycles. And there are a lot more. But also, from our point of view, there are some contrasts, there are some negative points. It's an unclear feature roadmap. When, at which point in time, will what feature be available? Uncertain stability. Is it really stable? What's now provided with that release? Will it be stable? Will it be the same two or three releases from now? The, at least currently, lacking maturity of the software. Can we use it for a carrier-grade network? Can we use it for carrier-grade requirements? And therefore, at least from our perspective, the carrier-grade version is currently not available. And again, on the con side, there are a lot more topics we had in our discussions. Nevertheless, we decided, okay, let's try open source. Let's see, it's promising, and let's see how it works. Will it work for us or not? We will see. We'll do the one or the other tests. We are doing some proof of concepts on different areas, in different locations, with different focus. But we are trying. And that leads me to my wish list for Christmas, as I said, is coming nearer. So there are some topics where we think there is work to be done. One thing is the upgrade, new release. Short release cycles, as I said, it's positive in principle, fast innovation cycles. Though if there is something which doesn't work as expected, it's very soon that you have a working version of it. That's great. But looking on an operator's business, when I look the old analog telephone, how long is it in our network? Look at the ISDN. How long is it in the network? So we are talking about long innovation and business investment cycles. You don't replace for 40, 50, 60 million customers, you don't just replace every year the technology in your network. Your business case wouldn't come out. So that's one problem. And at least the experience we make currently, you have to do a lot of configuration work. So it's not just installing a new software and everything runs. You have to check the configuration, does it work? And at least currently, the different maturity of the different OpenStack projects makes it hard to estimate the maturity of the overall software and how it can be used within our network. The APIs, okay, stable APIs are imperative. As I said before, if we install a new version, yeah, it should work as before. And if there are too many changes, we have to adapt a lot of stuff in within our network. And if we have, it's currently not the case, but if we are talking about a productive system and we have several VNFs, hopefully in future several hundred VNFs within our network, we can't adapt them all and we can't spend the effort to do regression tests with all of them. That would be several millions of person days and therefore several millions of euros which we have to spend, and of course that's not worth the effort. Again, it will kill any business case. Another thing is KPIs and SLAs. Currently, when buying a function as a silo, we can define in the contract some SLAs at the, let's say, customer side, throughput or whatever there will be. But if we just buy the software, we have to ensure KPIs at the low, at the upper end of our data center, let's say at the the hypervisor level. And on this KPIs, we have to provide, the VNF provider has to rely on in order to guarantee his SLAs. And if there's something going wrong, the finger pointing will start. Hey, your software doesn't work? No, Deutsche Telekom, your platform doesn't work. And then we start again the discussion, who is responsible for this fault? Who is responsible that, let's say, 1 million customer couldn't start a phone call or couldn't surf in the web or couldn't watch a Champions League final game or whatever. So that's another thing to think about. And how will this be influenced if there is a new release? Hopefully it gets better. But who guarantees it gets better? Maybe there's the one or the other thing it becomes worth? No one knows. And again, here, as mentioned before, the error handling, a breakup of silos means breakup of responsibilities. Yeah, and monitoring tools and measures also have to be provided in order to see where and in whose responsibility an error comes up. As mentioned as well in the film, and later on, multi-region is a topic for us. So we don't want to talk about 20-odd-something data centers. We talk about an infrastructure cloud. And we want to provide our application within this infrastructure cloud. Maybe it's necessary to provide an application, especially in Munich and not in Hamburg. So, or let's say in Munich and in Nuremberg and where else in the southern part of Germany, but not in the northern part of Germany, then we have to have measures to define the region where it is deployed. And of course, if we have the redundancy case, then in another region, the data center, the NFV or the VNF has to take over in case of failure in another data center. So multi-region or spatial redundancy or however you will call it is a need for us. Orchestration, of course. The whole stuff must be orchestrated. And in best case, the operational guys have just one tool, one monitor to look at, one screen to type and to handle the whole stuff, and not for each region a different tool, a different login, a different... It would become a nightmare. So that's, again, one thing. Security. Of course, our security guys are very strict, and if they don't approve, we won't go into production. And therefore, of course, we need from the application side security measures to avoid problems, to avoid security leaks, but also we need, at least from our point, also from the OpenStack side, some intrinsic security topics. And especially when talking about running more than one virtual network function on one bare metal, then you have to ensure that the virtual network function A does not corrupt the virtual function B or does something else with the virtual function B which is not allowed. So the whole stuff becomes, at least from our point, a very, very severe point. And of course, quality assurance is necessary, including also contributions from third-party vendors, of course, and should ensure the stability of APIs and also the external interfaces. So that's my wish list. Nevertheless, you may say, hey, he asks for a lot of things. Are they willing to contribute? I have to say, yes, we are willing to contribute. We already have some people, maybe not as much as we would like, within the OpenStack community, but we already have several contributors within the OpenStack community, especially in the QA section. I'm quite sure you know the statistics, just filtered the Deutsche Telekom people. So we are willing to contribute. We are contributing. We are willing to contribute. I hope I can convince my management that we can extend the manpower for contributing within OpenStack to bring this project forward and to make it a helpful project for Deutsche Telekom. Thank you for your attention so far. Are there any questions? Would you just take the mic, though the other people at the back can hear you?
Hi, Rod Randall from Cirrus Capital. As you look at the transition to NFV and the re-architecture of your network, Where would you place priorities on the financial benefits? Would it be in savings of cost from the infrastructure? Do you expect a different pricing of the network functions? Or do you expect it to be in the agility in the introduction of new services that give you new revenue opportunities? Or well, something else?
That's a good question. There are several screws to drive in order to make it successful. Yes, of course, one is the cost, and there probably be at our as our first calculations show, probably be the operational costs, okay. A driver. Of course, agility is a topic. Nevertheless, introducing such a kind of technology, introducing that decoupling of hardware and software, and become more agile, is also a transformation process within the organization.
Yes.
And it's a mind change. So we have the technology challenge, and we have also the mind change challenge. And therefore, I think the first step is, of course, the operational. And later on, coming together with the mind change within the organization will be the agility.
Okay. All right. Good. Thank you.
You're welcome. So there was another question in the first row. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Very good presentation. Marie Polodini from HP. There was somebody from Orange earlier in the week who said that, you know, definitely it's a technical challenge, but it's also a very strong cultural change, you know, in the operators. And he said that, you know, in Orange it would take, you know, at least 6 years or maybe more like 10 years. What is your take on that?
It's again a good question. So the let me give an answer like that. The we don't have currently a final roadmap, so I can't say, let's say, six years from today we will have all our network function virtualized. Nevertheless, we will, of course, have an approach using the life cycle of our network functions. Otherwise, we will get some problems with our financial guys. If you just replace a system you installed a year ago, just replace by a virtual system, they will say no way. So we will have our release cycles, which are between 3 and 5 years. So depending on the maturity of the underlying software, it will take at least 5 years till we have substituted our network functions, our siloed network functions, by virtual network functions. So I think the 5 to 6 year you mentioned, which was talked about the colleague from Orange, yes, that's reasonable.
Thank you.
My name is Raul Michelini. I'm from C3DNA, is a startup. One of the things that I come from a Telekom background, AT&T, Bell Labs, and so on and so forth. So one of the things that Telekom is good at is really Telekom grade service, and that was made possible by separation of the data path and the control path. So the signaling layer and so on and so forth. So in this architecture in the data center, you do not have a service control plane. So applications don't have a service control plane. So service management cannot be done without a service control plane. At the same time, infrastructure, if you want to provide an infrastructure to a service control plane, you have to have an infrastructure control plane that the service control plane can actually, you know, negotiate, saying, you know, hey, here is my resource requirements. You can provide however you provide your resources, and so on and so forth. So in the current data center architecture, there is a piece that is missing that used to be in the telecom industry, and the telecom grade trust came from the signaling layer, essentially. You know, as soon as you pick up the phone, there were resources, a profile of the application essentially told exactly what it needed. As soon as you dial the URL, the profile of the, you know, other dialed number told you what the network has to provide, and there was a lot of stuff that was happening. So that architecture is missing in the data center, with a single, you know, data path, everything is running around. And so to me, all of the efforts are not going to resolve the complexity because you're going to put managers of managers and managers of managers. So the orchestration is going to be extremely complex. So have you thought about separating actually the infrastructure control plane and the service control plane and having a signaling mechanism to negotiate?
Maybe I'm wrong and I didn't get your point completely, but what you were talking about is within the network function. So the network function itself, whether it's a phone service or whether it's an SMS service, of course, has to ensure the signaling to be working. But that has nothing to do with the data, with the infrastructure I need within the data center to get this network function up and running. Yeah, but yeah, but nevertheless, that's what our application orchestrator, what that block I showed here is doing. Yeah. That block is responsible for allowing a network function to use a resource or not, to providing the resource or to take away the resource. So there, of course, is the signaling. And that's via that way, there is information to the EMS or the, let's say, EMS and VNF manager within the EMS. They are talking about, they are negotiating, if you like, with each other. And then the application orchestrator, as a single point of truth, will provide an infrastructure and will of course, also take away if it's not used anymore.
That is the most important part of this
architecture. Yes, of course.
And that needs to be first really architected, which will drive everything else, really. Right?
Yeah.
So we are actually going bottom up. We don't have an architecture of that architecture layer.
Yeah.
And we are building all these blocks inside and outside without that architecture.
Right. But that's... Yeah, right, that's a missing piece, of course. And therefore, I said in my wish list, orchestration is one of the things I'd like to see.
Thank you, Mr. Häuser. Daniel Gotte from Ericsson. Was a very good presentation on NFV. Are you planning to kind of merge this project with the things which are going on in the IT cloud and the public cloud? So some of the operators have chosen to provide only one infrastructure for public IT and telco. Is that going to, I don't know, be a decision later on, or is that going to be an infrastructure only for NFV?
For the current point in time, it's focused on the NFV because it's focused on our business regarding the network, or our network-centric business, as I may say. Maybe there will be later on another step of evolution to bring this together, but not decided for today.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I'm Harshad Tanna from Ericsson, again, cloud manager project in Ericsson. So it's very good that you mentioned that there is a single point of truth or control for the infrastructure resources, and that's the view that we have also taken, but seems like ETSI is moving in the direction of allowing VNF managers to directly go into infrastructure orchestration. So
yep.
That really puts vendors like us into a dilemma how to go about it. Any comments?
Yeah, and not only vendors like you, but also providers like us. We also have the discussions with our vendors and have to convince them, no, you're not allowed to do with the infrastructure what you like. You're only allowed to do what we like. And that's really a crucial point from our point of view. I don't want to say ETSI didn't think carefully enough about there may be other reasons, or there are other reasons behind that. But nevertheless, that's our approach, and that's our approach we are fighting for. In of course. We just, regarding the L3 picture, we just cut this connection. Maybe we will have, let's say that the VNF manager may listen. That's okay, but he may not control, or must not control, to make it clear. Okay, there's another question at the end.
It's very quick. Carlos Gonçalves from NEC Europe. From the OP NFV project website, I think that Deutsche Telekom has not joined the project. There are a lot more operators involved. Why haven't Deutsche Telekom joined, or is it a political reason behind, or technical? Are you joining later?
Not decided for today. Nevertheless, there are a lot of initiatives and groups popping up like mushrooms. And the problem is the resources. You need to have the resources, and you need to ensure that the resources of one company within all those groups provide the same opinion. And the same statements, and so far no decision. If we shall also participate in the Open NFV group, it's, as I said, we have to discuss how far we will go into that topic.
Okay, thanks.
Yes, hi, Arno Tadei from Symantec. The question I get from your business unit people, in fact, on the consumer, SMB, and enterprise side, is we all understand the agility, the cost reduction, and so on, but your teams are really concerned about, will it make more money? Will it make more revenue? Are you considering scenario, use cases, where you could create innovation paths, and what it means for you?
Yes, that's that point. To be more flexible, to be more active, or even, which I have to admit, when one of our competitors is faster than we are, to be more reactive. So that's, of course, a point where we think, yeah, we can do that. But as I said before, it needs also a mind change within the organization, and therefore it's nothing I see in the, let's say, short future. But at least midterm, yes, of course. Yep.
Regarding the line cut between the infrastructure orchestration and the VNF manager, I wanted to understand your rationale behind that. I don't want to make it a design discussion, but how do you envision changes in the infrastructure or the VNF manager having to make an auto-scale decision and thereby requesting some virtual resources, etc.? So there's many scenarios, and how do you handle those if you bypass that connection?
Okay, the short answer is that way. The rationale behind, as I said, if you are talking about, let's say currently we just checked part of our organization units, and we came about 450, 480 services. So if you virtualize all of them, and all of the 400 or 500 or maybe 800 or even 100 services are talking directly to your infrastructure without one single point of truth, you will have chaos. And virtualized chaos, as one of our managers says, virtualized chaos is still chaos. Even more complex. So that's the point behind that. Because if everyone may talk, may ask for resources, may block resources without one referee over it, we may run into the problem that we still have lots of unused resources because they are blocked by one VNF manager on what decision ever and are not available for other VNFs. So that's the point behind it. We need this control unit, this referee, and therefore we say our single point of truth is this up there. And if we NF requests more resources, it has to be done via this orchestration, via this single point of truth, which knows which resources are available, where are these resources available, does the policy of the VNF allow that, let's say, resources in Hamburg, in the northern part of Germany, are required, and does the application allow that these resources will be in the southern part, in Munich, provided. Not all of our applications will allow, if you need in Hamburg more resources, that in Munich these resources are provided. So, and therefore we said just that way and not directly. Okay, then I'm over my time. Thank you for your attendance. Thank you for your questions.